one third of his stories completely based on the children's perspective. Well, I believe the author of the day has just arrived. So once he comes to the dais, we will all stand and welcome him. And then we will start the proceeding. Thank you so much for your discipline. And yes, just after his address, as you all know, we'll have an interactive session where you will, if you have any questions, but we believe that you will have questions, you can ask, and we will try to solve all those kind of aspirations that you are just trying to put forth before the noted author today. Thank you, and I will just catch you up within a short while. So, dear children, here is the time which we all were waiting for. Our noted speaker, the pacer, Sindra Narayan Das, has just arrived. Thank you so much. Please be seated. August gathering. Before we start the proceeding of the day, with a formal note, I just want to quote Martin Luther King Jr. What he said once: if you can't fly, then run. If you can't run, then walk. If you can't walk, then crawl. But whatever you do, you have to keep moving forward. As a team at Devi Public School Chandrasekharpur, we have been trying hard and we'll strive to keep the will, roll on despite the tough times. Respecting the rich tradition of our institution, I'd like to request all the distinguished members and the gathering to kindly rise up for the DAV Gaan.
अविरल निर्मल सलिल सदय ज्ञान प्रदायिनी ज्योतिर्मय हो चहु दिशि उद्घोष अभय दिए विजय जय दिए विजय जय प्रबल प्रवाह मई नित नूतन जीवन दायिनी सदा सनातन वेद प्रणीता परम पुनीता ये धारा अक्षय दिए विजय जय दिए विजय जय दयानंद से प्रेम भक्ति ले हंस राज से त्याग शक्ति ले धर्म भक्ति का राष्ट्र शक्ति का हो दिन मान उदय दिए विजय जय दिए विजय जय सुख समृद्धि इसकी लहरें प्रेम शांति इसके तट ठहरे सघन शांतिमय प्रबल क्रांतिमय लिए अटल निश्चय दिए विजय जय दिए विजय जय
थैंक यू एवरीवन प्लीज टू टेक योर सीट्स Esteemed invitee of the day, Professor Jitendra Narayan Das, Revered Principal cum Regional Officer of DAV Institutions, Odisha Zone 1, Dr. Kesab Chandra Satpathy, Esteemed Coordinator, Madam Indira Bhattacharya, Academic Supervisors, Teachers, Parents, and loving children present on an offline mode. On behalf of DAV Public School Chandrasekharpur and Dr. Radhadamana Central Library, I'd like to welcome you all to the second day celebration of the National Book Week and specially to the event Meet the Author 2021. Which has certainly turned out to be an annual ritual at our institution. Today, we are delighted to have with us a very renowned writer, columnist, and academician, Professor Jitendra Narayan Das, who is very popularly known as Das Banner among his readers and well-wishers. The prominent author, Professor Das, hails from a very humble background of Khandapada, Nayagarh, a former princely state in the undivided district of Puri. With strong dedication and discipline, he scaled to the heights of his character, discharging all responsibilities entrusted upon him time to time. As a distinguished academician, he inspired many graduate, postgraduate students and saved their career by teaching political science in different government colleges of Odisha. The Pathfinder finally called it a day from his long 35 years of meritorious service. Retiring as a principal from the very reputed SCS Autonomous College, Puri, the land of the Lords. As it is said, the true sign of intelligence is not knowledge, but imagination. Dr. Das had picked up the skill of imagination from the very tender age of his life. Proficiency in reading and writing came naturally to him. Those formative years' fascinating passions inspired the young mind to give a perfect shape to his imaginary skills in terms of writing. And you'll be amazed to know he has already published 150 books, including short stories, poems, novels, essays, travelogues, out of which about two-thirds is for children of all ages. As a newspaper columnist, he has been writing on socio-political and cultural aspects of Odisha and India, highlighting the contemporary issues for the last 40 years. His interest in literature is reflected in his writing, editing, and organizing workshops since he started his journey as a writer in late 70s. Due to his immense contribution to the world of literature, he has been conferred with a number of prestigious awards by various reputed organizations in the country. It includes the Odisha Sahitya Academy Award in 1987, the National Prize Competition for Children's Literature in 1989, organized by NCERT New Delhi, Bal Sahitya Puraskar in 2014 by Sahitya Academy New Delhi, Fakir Mohan Galpa Samman in 1995 by Utkal Sahitya Samaj Katak, Popular Science Writer Award in 1999 by Odisha Vigyan Academy, Bhubaneswar, Utkal Gaurav Madhusudan Samman in 2012 by Salepur College, Katak, Odisha Bahimela Puraskar in 2013 by Odia Bahimela, Kalinga Saraswat Samman in 2014 by Chetavani Sahitya Sansad, Kalahandi, Biswanath Prasad Saraswat Samman in 2017 by Biswanath Prasad Smriti Committee, Katak, and a plethora of awards to his credit. So I just do not want to take much time of yours before we invite such an eminent person to address us. May I request our Reverend Principal, sir, to formally welcome the noted speaker to our campus. So please.
Good morning and namaskar. Today I am very happy to find a teacher on this podium who is invited particularly to address you. When I was a student, he was a teacher. He was teaching us. So being a teacher, I feel happy that my teacher has come here to address my gathering. So just a fresh postgraduate appointed as the lecturer of Bhadra College, I met him when I was 15, 16 years old. And we are calling at that time the teachers because usually they are 4-5 years senior to us, that bhai. Another English teacher was there also, Raja Bhai, we are calling. Sir was there, the most handsome man among us. I am going back in the history 40 years back when I was a student like you. So I am really very happy to extend a hearty welcome to him from this podium, because this day will be written in the golden letters of the school, because a teacher of your teachers is invited to address you. Sir, on behalf of all the students, on behalf of the managing committee, I extend a hearty welcome to you, sir. I am also happy that after 2 years, I am getting the chance to see you all, because in the last 2 years, I have not seen the students are sitting in a large number in front of me. So I feel today very happy that you people are there, and I pray God that let the normalcy comes to the earth, because not only India or Odisha is affected, through all the world is affected by this coronavirus. So I also extend a welcome note to all the students and the teachers, my colleagues, and everybody who are involved with this arrangement. Thank you very much, because as your anchor has already told you, sir, that we will not take much time, because we will listen to him. Thank you. Jai Hind, Vande Utkal.
Thank you so much, sir, for revealing this secret. And now is the time that we all have been waiting for. May I request a very eminent, noted speaker of the day, Professor Jitendra Narayan Das, to kindly address all of us. So please.
Namaskar. I am particularly happy because I have been given a chance to meet so many budding flowers. Once Alexander said, Vini Vidi Vishi, I came, I saw, and I conquered. Here, I came, I saw, and I am bowled out. It is really fantastic, the atmosphere maintained here, the kind of discipline you have maintained, and the kind of reputation you have, not only in the state, throughout the country. I would beseech upon you to please continue the kind of heritage you have been given by your renowned principal, Dr. K.C. Shatpathy. Principal, sir, nobody is here. I am only addressing the empty chairs. Madam Bhattacharya, my friend Devendra, I know they are there, but I am not having them here. That's why I said, and my teacher friends, those who are present here, and student friends, I wish I were a teacher of this great institution. Today the program is to meet the author. But you are listening to the author by way of meeting. I don't know if we can meet person to person ever. Listening to somebody is also a kind of meeting. I remember once Gulzar told me that I have met Munshi Premchand thrice. I said, how come you were born after Munshi Premchand left this world? And how you met him? He said, once when I was a tiny boy, my mother told me a story written by Guljar. The title of the story is Eid. I listened to the story and I met Guljar. Then when I was a student in the 7th class, I read one of the stories of Guljar. I met Guljar for the second time then. Then afterwards, I was to give a lecture on Munshi Premchand and I had to read his stories. And again, I met him thrice. So listening is also meeting. That I am meeting you and I am talking to you and you are listening to me is a kind of meeting. And this is a tradition in India. People might think that Indians are, they were thinking, because now the literacy level is quite high, they were maintaining that Indians are illiterate because their literacy level is very low. I had the opportunity to address a big gathering once outside India, and I told them, most of the Indians from time immemorial are educated through their ears. There were Puran Pandas. There were storytellers. And in each village, these Purans were being recited by and interpreted by educated people. It is not necessary to read to develop your knowledge. Listening has great power. And stories particularly have great power. You must have heard about Panchatantra. The king was Amara Shakti, and he had three sons who were not interested in reading, writing, anything. They were not interested. But came Vishnu Sharma. Vishnu Sharma, when he came and he started telling stories to the princes, these stories educated them. You must have heard about Alfred the Great. Among all the monarchs, kings of England, Alfred the Great is treated to be the best of them. You must know that his two other brothers said, it is not our duty to read or to listen because we have to win in the wars to be great kings. But Alfred the Great, because his mother had prepared a book, then books were prepared of wooden planks. And because of his reading, because of his capacity to listen to others, the bishops, the storage, he became a great king. In India particularly, education was being imparted through storage. Purans are that. Ramayana is a story about truth. The entire Ramayana, which is a conglomerate of so many other stories, speaks about truth. How Rama, the protagonist, the main character in Ramayana, how he maintained truth. And what is Mahabharata? If you go through the entire Mahabharata, again, a composite of fantastic stories. It speaks about Rashtra Dharma. Today we call it politics. And what is this Bhagavat? Again, it's a conglomerate of different stories which speaks about the life of Krishna and the aim is bhakti. Friends, I must tell you that stories have built India over the years. That is why even today, when we ask somebody, give us the example of two fantastic brothers, two real brothers, they come with Ram and Lakshman, Ram and Bharat. Look at the capacity of the story that is there from thousands of years. Now, coming to this meeting the author program, I must tell you there is a difference between authors, writers, and literatures. All writers are not authors. You might be thinking that everybody who is a writer is also an author, no? And all authors or writers are not literatures. There is a difference. Since it's a school, I venture to speak this. Authors, those who possess original ideas, they are authors. And therefrom comes this word authoritativeness. But anybody can write anything. You can imitate, you can write. So a writer with originality, authority on his own ideas, is an author. I don't know whether I am an author, but a literateur, he could be a ghost writer, he could be a pen pusher, even he could be a translator, an interpreter, a critic. They all come under the category of literateurs. I am very happy that you considered me an author. It is a great prestige. Now, coming to that, what really it does? Why should we be interested in literature? Because this is the age of technology and science. You should win in mathematics Olympiad, science Olympiad. There are so many areas. Now this world, the knowledge of this world is reverberating with researches in technology, in science. There are so many branches. And why should you be interested in literature? I must tell you, to our memory, because we had very old universities like, say, in Nalanda, Takshashila, but we don't have records. Even Plato's Academy, they don't have records. This Oxford University started in 1167, in the 12th century. Do you know what subjects they had at the beginning? Because daily knowledge is proliferating, and from the same subject. Once I taught political science, it was originally with economics. Now political science has so many other branches, like say, policy science, public administration, international law, so many areas. So likewise, everyday knowledge is proliferating. But Oxford University started with four subjects. Those are the four seminal subjects: philosophy, mathematics, history, and literature. History is the mother of all social sciences. Mathematics is the mother of all natural sciences. And philosophy is an independent branch which is mother of all ideas. And literature is the mother of all these three. I will tell you. You must have been given ample of definitions defining literature. Somebody must have said or told you that it is the mirror of the society. It is that sweetest feeling that came to you automatically when you looked at a flower or any object or an incident. Yes, literature is all that. But literature, whether it is a story or a drama or a piece of poem or a small couplet, even a riddle, I tell you, all other subjects, they appeal your mind, your science, your mathematics, everything. But literature is that which appeals to your heart directly. Literature informs you, entertains you, inspires you, enlightens you through your heart. And through the heart, it goes to mind. So the kind of knowledge literature gives you, even the kind of relaxation literature gives you, the kind of information literature gives you, it passes through your heart. And once it registers here, you become a different person. I am interested to tell you a Sanskrit couplet. Nalini dala jalabat sansare sarvam asthiram. Kirti hi rakshana sambandha sthira bhavati bhutale. Everybody is interested to gain fame. It is necessary because you know man is defined differently. Somebody said that man is a laughing being. Somebody said man is the most rational animal. But man is the only animal that tries to gain identity. Dale Carnegie has given the definition of this. He says if you take a group photograph and give it to somebody, he will look at his only face. First he will look at, he will try to find out where is he in the crowd. It is because man is always interested in himself. Man is the only animal who is interested in his own identity. Even as students, you always try that I must secure good marks. I must be treated by the teachers as the best boy. You need your identity. Why I told you that I want to be a teacher here? Because of the identity the school has maintained. Your school has a definite identity and you need to have an identity within the school. And those who do not have identity, they search for identity, quest for identity, they don't succeed. You might be thinking why this man is speaking about all this without telling a story. I'll go to that. But I tell you, man tries to gain identity and the main intention is to gain fame. There is nobody who does not want fame, who does not want identity, recognition. That is why it was said, the man who said that even Caesar can be flattered, that means everybody wants flattery. Flattery is not a bad thing so long as it recognizes your talent, real talent. So of all the kind of fame, or you can say fames, that fame which is linked to written words remains for a very, very long time. Any fame that is linked to words is the most, not particularly permanent, most permanent. It lives long. I tell you, Ramayana. They say Ramayana is 5,000 years old. And through Ramayana, we know Valmiki, the author. Give me one piece of thing that is there, which is man-made and is still there for more than 5,000 years. This building will not last. No picture, nothing will last. Because you know that the mountains, they lose their identity over 1,000 years. The same mountain which had this shape will lose its shape in 1000 years. And the plants, they lose their inner quality. That is why Sushruta has said that the medicinal value that was there in the plants, they change over the years. So we'll have to find out the same properties in other plants. Plants change their shape, change their quality. Mountains change their shape, and rivers change their shapes, the flow. There are so many dead rivers. Language also changes after 10 kilometers, every 10 kilometers. Nothing is permanent. But kirti hi akshara sambandha sthira bhavati bhutale. A Valmiki is remembered. He's gone. His words in Ramayana keeps him alive in us. That is how a great story has the capacity, because one invention can be superseded by another invention. One discovery will be lost, another discovery will take its place. This building is here, after say hundreds of years, this building will not be there. But the story that has appealed to the human heart will continue forever. A Ramayana will continue, a Mahabharata will continue, a Bhagavata will continue, a Panchatantra will continue, a Kathasagar will continue, Kathasarit Sagar will continue, a Ravan Nights will continue. Stories continue to educate people. Stories are fantastic elements to educate the common mass, and more so the educated mass. You are reading here. Your teacher is teaching you. Mathematics is being taught. Dr. Satpathy is a professor of mathematics. Botany is being taught. Social science is being taught. But when the teacher is teaching you, the kind of story he adds might be a personal story within that, or a story he had heard. That story will remain in you forever. When I close my eyes, I remember my teacher who once told a nice story to me. Stories have a continuing value, not all stories. That is why, what is classic? A classic is that which has continuing values. A classic story has more staying power. A classic piece of literature has more staying power compared to all other artifacts in this world. Literature is an artifact created by human beings. Whether it is a poem, piece of poem, or a story. Because I tell you, Mopasa has said, you might be thinking, which came first? The short story, the novel, the play, or a poem, which came first? To this, Mopasa has given the answer. He says, poetry was there already in nature. The murmuring sound of the brook, the chattering sound of the birds, it was already poetry there. We only put words into that. But it is the story that came to human beings as first piece of literature. When man was living in the forest, even the family was not created. They were having animalist life, but they were sitting together besides fire. And when they, because words were not there, but they were expressing themselves, their experiences to themselves. So with this kind of gesticulation, they were expressing their experiences of the day to each other. That is the beginning of story. And to my mind, whether it is a piece of poem or a piece of essay. Because the real interpretation of essay is a literary attempt. All these are essays really. But I tell you that story is the basic kernel, the basic epicenter of all literary attempts. Now coming to the stories, I tell you, classic stories leave behind the most important impact in human beings and more so in young minds like you. I shall tell you an Egyptian folk tale. It's a very simple folk tale. Once the king was, you know, the king, this lion is the king of the forest, God knows. Because nowadays I see in different channels that lions are being attacked by hyenas. But we have accepted lion to be the king of the forest. We don't consider elephant to be the king of the forest. We consider lion to be the king of the forest and he's violent. Now we have accepted tiger to be the national animal of India. I'm sorry for this elephant. I wish elephant should have been the king. Because he's the most non-violent animal. Because of our own doing, they are coming to the cities and creating troubles. Anyway, so the king was, this lion was having his conference or say kind of sabha in the jungle. All the animals were present. The tiger, the bear, everybody, the birds also. Then there came a small monkey, a child monkey. He stood up inside the sabha hall and challenged the lion. He said, "Oh lion, you are the king of the forest. I don't care. I want a duel with you." Everybody started laughing. Why this child monkey is taking up this challenge? He will be mauled by the lion easily. One push will kill him. But no, this child monkey stood very firm, straight looked at the lion's face. Everybody started laughing, but the lion did not laugh. After a period of time, he said, "Yes, okay. Tomorrow, by say, after the sunrise, we will have the duel here. And I invite all the animals to be present." Everybody started talking, this king is really, he has gone mad. How to have a fight between a lion and a child monkey, baby monkey? It is no match. It is very unnatural. Everybody started leaving the place. Tomorrow they will come and gather. So the next morning, all the animals found that the monkey has already come, the child monkey. All were waiting for the lion to come. Minutes passed, hours passed, the lion did not come. What is the moral of the story? I tell you, it is here the most important thing is bravery wins. The lion thought, this baby monkey, which will die if just I push it, he's challenging means there is somebody behind him. There is some supernatural power in him. Otherwise, he would not have ventured to challenge me. Or might be all these animals, those who are my subjects, they are behind him. Once I start fighting with him, they will all gather and kill me. Or might be in the neighboring jungle, neighboring forest, there must be other animals, those who have sent him. And that is why he has the courage to challenge me, a lion. So he decided to leave the forest. So the moral is, don't think that you are helpless. We have numbers of stories which say that it is bravery which wins. Not only bravery in duel or fighting, in classes also. If you are given a difficult psalm, don't hide your face. If you are given a difficult home task, don't hide your face. You will win. That is why that song, "We Shall Win." And the second story is a very recent story. During this corona period, a child of, say, class 5 or 6, he lost his father. It is a story of 2020. It was in a remote village. He was the only son. They were living, say, on the kind of earning his father was having. The family became immediately poor because they had nothing, they had not saved anything. Anyway, but the child is reading and he needs support. He was going to a tuition to a nearby village. So between these two villages, there was a small forest. And daily his father was taking him from his house to the tutor's house in the other village. Now it so happened, because of fear, because the forest is there, mother did not allow him, and he also was so very afraid that he did not go to the teacher. Then some days after, his aunt came to visit them. The aunt knew the problem. He said, "I will support you. You don't worry. The child should go to the tutor as usual. Otherwise, his studies will be hampered." But this boy was not prepared. Then aunt asked him, "Why you are not prepared to go to the tutor? You were going for the last 2 years, you were going." He said, "No, mother can't take me, you can't also take me, and I can't go on my own because I'm afraid of that forest." Then his aunt told him, "There is a way. When you enter into the forest, you just start singing a song loudly, and it will be better if you recite a prayer extolling the Lord, a janana, a bhajan." The boy did the same thing. When he entered into the forest, he started singing. And when he reached the teacher's house, he forgot that he had already passed through the forest. And the same thing happened when he returned. Now his aunt asked him, "Do you know why you no longer have the same fear?" "Because your voice became your companion. Your voice can be your companion. That is why when we are lonely, if you start singing, you get a companion. And this song is about the Lord. You have a better companion." So friends, don't be afraid of anything. Don't be afraid of loneliness. Yes, I had a father. He is no more. But we all know there is somebody. He may be selfless, but there is somebody who should be accepted as our father. If he is the father of all, how can I lose my father? That is the beauty of prayer. When you pray, don't ask for anything. Because prayer is not to ask anything. That is why the better word is bhajan. You go on extolling the contribution of the Lord. So the first thing was that bravery wins. Second is your own words, your own voice could be your companion. And the third story will be, because a story of mine was there in CBSE course from 1990 to 2010 for 20 years. It is no longer there. I will tell that story for the benefit of my little elder students. It can also interest my young friends. There was a family in which there were three brothers. And you know, once there was a time when the economy was totally agricultural economy. Now there is a change in the society. Most of the people in the villages, those who are educated, they come to the cities because opportunities that they are in the cities. As we live, most of you must be trying to go to Australia, to USA, because opportunities are there, research opportunities are there, best schools and colleges are there, Harvard, Wharton, Oxford, Cambridge. I was not a good student, but I had the opportunity to visit this MIT. You must go. But this change that has come over us must be looked into with proper rationality. Not that we'll neglect all the villages. If we come to the cities, that doesn't mean that we'll leave the villages to be ruined. If I go to America, we must gain knowledge, but our focus should be to keep our country its head high. You have a responsibility. You have a responsibility to your parents, to your neighbors, to your friends, to the school, to the teachers, to the environment. I'm very happy that way because I can share it with my friend, Dr. Satpathy. Because my son, he's an IIT and also a Wharton MBA. My daughter-in-law is also the same. They were in America. Now they have chosen to come back and start their own business here with the knowledge they have acquired there. So I tell you, time is changing always. Once we are all in the villages, now we are bound to come to the cities, but that does not mean we should focus only on the cities, not in the village, on the villages. India is still a country of villages, having 70% of the population and 68% in agriculture. So these three brothers, out of these three brothers, one brother got the opportunity, got educated and came to the city. And the eldest brother, who was really feeding the entire family after the death of his father or their father, he was looking after everything. And you know, an idle mind is the devil's workshop. So this middle brother, he started, and particularly his wife, he always started humming that we should get separated. Because the eldest brother had two or three children. They were sharing the food. They were sharing the property. So partition came up. So one day, the eldest brother wrote a letter to the youngest one asking him to come over for the partition. And like most of us, once we left the village, we never visit the villages unless there is some work. That is not to be. Because if I am a student of this school, throughout my life, I must be indebted to this school. That will keep my rationality in proper equilibrium. Gratefulness is the greatest of qualities in human beings. Those who lose it, they really lose the nectar of life. So this brother came and he found that all the belongings of the family are placed in the courtyard. Even the watch his brother had mortgaged for his higher studies, that is also there. The small things, the articles used by his father, grandfather, because everything is to be divided into three. And when he went there, before that, his wife told him, you see, if you get 1/3 of the property, to my calculation, it will be some 2-3 lakhs. So first I will have this, then I will have that, I will have a carpet, I will have that, this. She made a list of things. And this man agreed, the youngest boy. Now he went there and his eldest brother came to the bus stand. As usual, he carried his bag, saying that, no, you are tired, I will take your bag. And as it is usual with elder brothers, he is thinking that the man is the same. What I have done for the family, what I have done for my elder brother, and what I have done for the home which really nourished me. So he is looking at all the articles kept on the yard, agona. He is thinking, what is my contribution? Why should I take? Now the property is divided into three. The youngest boy said, what shall I do with all these belongings? You share it among yourselves. So the land, when it was divided, it was divided into three parts. In the afternoon, the eldest brother asked this youngest brother, you come, because you don't know which land is yours now. You have never gone to the field. From your childhood, you were a good student, but you have never gone to the field. Now you are the owner of this land, cultivable land. You come and see. So now when the youngest brother is following the eldest brother, he sees the footprints of his brother, eldest brother, because throughout his life, he has worked in the field. Because he is the man who was toiling hard to feed the entire family. He was really disturbed. He had no way to escape this because he has promised his wife that the part of land which I will have, I will sell it out and I will give you the money so that you can purchase things as you have desired. And on the other hand, he sees that this land which fed us is now divided. And the man who really toiled hard to maintain this is given 1/3. And wherever I see, there is the footprint of my brother. The next day he had to leave the village for Bhubaneswar. The entire night he could not sleep. In the morning he is asking his sister-in-law, where is elder brother? He said, no, he has gone to the heart to purchase fish for you because he knows you like small fish and with tamarind soup, you like it. That's why he has gone to purchase some fish. The youngest boy thinks, look at the family. I have come to divide the family and take away property from my brothers, but this brother of mine, the eldest one, he is still in his old habit and he still considers me the youngest one. So he wrote a small piece of paper. In that he wrote that, brother, what shall I do with this land? I have a job there in the city. and you live on this land. Should I take it away? You are my land. I offer you at your feet. Please help me by accepting this land. He wrote this, gave the piece of paper to his sister-in-law. Then he escaped. That is the end of the story. But I tell you, you are all my young friends. Most of us, those who live in Bhubaneswar, Cuttack, or these urban areas, we are owners of land. We are absent landlords. Most of us, ask your parents. They have handsome income here. But they own the land which they have never visited. But they will not part with it. They will not leave it to anyone, any relation of his. Even if you are the only son, if you are not tilling the land, you have no right to keep it barren. I tell you, friends, I am very happy. We are four brothers. My father is dead. I have not taken anything from the family. That has given me greatest courage. That story of own story that I wrote back when Dr. Satpathy was a student there in 78, I wrote that story. That gave me enough courage to be myself. So to be honest to yourself is the greatest virtue you can acquire. So friends, try to be brave. Try to be your own voice. And try to be rational and virtuous. God bless you. Thank you.
I certainly do not have any words. Sir, you absolutely left us speechless. And the way you narrated the stories, just putting your own experience, your own life history, it was absolutely amazing. The way you started with mythology, to science, to the stories and those three lessons. And I'm sure that the young minds who all are listening to you today will definitely must have been very, very enlightened. So dear students, it's time that we will take some of your queries. If you have any questions for our eminent author, so it's time for you. No doubt, we do have a very short time, but if you have any, so you can just put it before us. You can raise up your hand or you can stand so that the mic will reach to you.
Good afternoon, sir. So I have a doubt that when authors write a book, sometimes they don't have the incentive or the momentum to write it, or they do not have any good ideas, which is called the writer's block. So how do you overcome with that?
Could you please repeat?
Yes, sir. I was asking that sometimes the author sometimes the authors, when they write a book, they do not get the incentive or the momentum to write it, or they do not have any good ideas, which is called the writer's block. Yes, sir. So how do you overcome that?
It's a very nice question. Thank you. What's your name?
My name is Tejaswini.
Tejaswini? Oh, fantastic name. You have seen Tendulkar playing. He has scored centuries. And you have seen him also getting out without a score. Why it happens? Usually, whether it is a play, a game, or anything, even if you are a singer, Lata Mangeshkar can't sing always. You usually lose your form. So to gain your form, you should be always at it. Don't leave it. Many think, why do you know? It is there is a saying that academic gatherings seldom produce fertile results. It is only because they don't remain at it. So to be a writer or an author, if you are not getting enough incentive, but or you are not in form, you should keep on writing. Don't leave writing. Like the cricketer, if Tendulkar gets out, say this time in 2 innings, he got out without scoring, you should not leave cricket. Without, he could not be Tendulkar. So you will have to be at it. Continue. Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
Good afternoon, sir. I was asking, how do you first start to write a story? How do you start a story? Do you first think about the characters or do you first think about the synopsis of the story?
Again, a very nice question. You are not a writer, suppose.
Yes.
I ask you, what's your name?
Karika. Karika Tanvi.
Sarita.
Karika Tanvi.
Karika. Yes. Oh. Nowadays, there are different types of names with which we are not acquainted. Karika, suppose I asked you, can you just tell me your childhood, how you spent it? You will ask me, sir, which part of childhood? I will ask you, no, when you went to the school for the first time, when you came to DAV school for the first time, you start telling? Do you frame a story then? But you are telling a story. So story is an automatic narration that touched your heart. Those who write stories with a chamak beginning, fantastic beginning, thinking that I will end with a fantastic end, that is not a story, that is not a natural story. So when you, as you speak naturally, if you narrate an incident naturally, that is a story. Because the world is full of stories. You can have a story on this bottle. You can have a story on this, anything. But the thing is, how you are narrating it. That is the beauty. Because all these students, they have come to the school for the past time once. There must have been a beginning. So therefore, if you want to write a story, straightway begin with it. Because as you explain your life experiences to others, suppose you are asking your father, Papa, you tell me what happened today in the office. He will tell you. He will not use any kind of ornamental language or anything. He will tell his experience of the day. That is a story. So the story is that simple. And once you go into it, then you start focusing on important areas that will make the story beautiful. But otherwise, story is just a narration. Okay? Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Good morning, sir. So my name is Priyanshi Das from AD.
It's already beyond 12. So good afternoon.
Well, it's afternoon.
Okay. Good afternoon, sir.
Yeah.
Yes, sir. So I wanted to ask if you are forward to write another book. So then from which topic would you like to choose your themes for the next book?
Themes really vary. Because daily we see a changing world. The thing is, whether you are writing a story or a novel or a poem, you should give importance to that part which inspire you and which is to be told to others all are seeing this. Suppose I saw this school. If you ask two writers to write about the school, they will write two different stories because their vision is different. Suppose there is a piece of wood here. Someone is asked to explain that. Madam will say it's a piece of art. An ordinary man will say it's a piece of wood. Another poet will say, oh, it looks like a woman who is famished, has not got food for several days. So it is your viewpoint as you see it. So therefore, any incident that inspires you and you need to tell it to others, you should go for that. Okay? So experiences worth sharing are the basis of all these writings. Got the point?
Yes, sir. Thank you.
Good afternoon, sir. My name is Pandan Panigrahi from 8B. My question was, do you despise copying in any manner or is copying all right if you try to learn from the particular artist or writer how they, what is their writing process?
You see, we are all copycats.
Yes.
I am a copycat of my father. Because I am carrying his gene. So usually, whatever you read, whatever you experience, that is copied in you. But when it becomes deliberate, I see a piece of writing written by you and I just get it down, that is copy. Imitating somebody is not even copy. Because most of our cultural mores, cultural activities are mere imitations. When I write, say, I draw a flower, I'm just copying the natural flower here. I'm imitating, not copying, I'm imitating. So imitation is not bad. But those people, there are very few people, because you know there are two types of drawing, memory drawing and natural drawing. When you memorize something and draw a picture, that is inferior to that original drawing. Okay? So imitating something is not bad. But creating something new is better than imitation. That is the thing.
Thank you, sir.
Welcome.
Good morning, sir.
Good morning.
Good afternoon, sir.
Again, good afternoon. We are in the twilight zone now.
Sir, why do you use Das Benho to write books, but not your original name?
I should tell you, do you know Rabindranath Tagore was writing using a pen name at the beginning?
Yes, sir.
That was Bhanu Singh. Even our Fakir Mohan Senapati was using a pen name that was Durjati. Your Mark Twain, his original name is Samuel L. Clemens. George Eliot is a male name, but she is a female. I tell you, George Eliot thought that if I use my own name, which is a female name, people will not give that attention. So she changed the name and became George Eliot. In my case, I was in my MA class. You know, we have all great longing to write in English, to be international. Before we become national, we want to be international. So I wrote a an essay in English and it got published in Hindustan Standard. That paper is no longer here. So when it got published, I was in the cloud nine. I gave it to a friend of mine who read it and appreciated it and jotted down a few lines from that essay. And I know he was a better student, first class career, better student. He was also best student. So I thought elated that my writing is now being quoted by my friend and he takes down two or three sentences from that. Then he asked me whose writing it is. It was written as I was using J.N. Das, Jitendra Narayan Das. He did not believe it. He said, no, you must not have written it. It must have been written by someone else. You are saying it is yours. I said, no, I have the photocopy with me. At that time, photocopy was not there. I said the carbon copy. Then he became silent, thoughtful, and I found him to be sad. So I felt that he was now praising this piece. Now he started again saying that, oh yes, this is a good piece, but it would have been better if you had done this, that. He started saying so many things. So I found that my own writing, which was appreciated by a friend of mine, now that he knew it is written by me, he's not accepting in the same manner. It is 1974. The incident happened in 1974. In that year, this Swati cinema hall came up. I did not know that there is a cinema, but I, in order to escape the hostel Vanivir, I went there. Saw that cinema. It was an English cinema, English movie. The name is Ben-Hur. B-E-N-H-U-R. Ben means son, Hur means family. It's a fantastic film. It is a 1959 film which bagged 11 Oscar awards. The whole story, the character Ben-Hur appealed me like anything. Throughout the story, throughout the movie, I cried. And there was a kind of emotional purgation. I decided that I will not write in my original name. I will pick up a pen name like so many, because Sarala Das was Siddheshwar Parida. Bhakta Charan Das, that Kahoi Manuara, Manuare Bobolokara, he is also Bairagi Charan Patnaik. So many people have changed their names. So I decided, since my surname is Das, and most of the Odia writers have accepted Das, Sarala Das, Bacha Das, Markanda Das, these are not original names. Since my surname is Das, I made it Das Ben-Hur. And ironically, I came up with a letter pad with Das Ben-Hur and date. And at that time, I was writing English poetry. Youth Times was a magazine which was encouraging youth, that was published by Times of India Group. Wherever I sent my poems, they got published. The name clicked. Yusuf Khan became Dilip Kumar and his name clicked. Jitendra Das became Das Ben-Hur. It clicked. So that's why I am Das Ben-Hur.
Thank you, sir. Good afternoon, sir. First of all, I would like to thank for this wonderful, enlightening, informative, as well as educative session. And my heartfelt thanks to our principal, sir, who always gives us these chances. I would say this is a children's gift to not only to for all of our children, but for all of us. Sir, I have two questions. The first one, my question is a little long, so I have typed it. As a writer, how much the readers influence your writing? As you write stories, usually you have to keep the readers' appreciation or their analysis in mind while writing. And hence the readers' interference is inevitable while telling a story. Then whose story actually it is? It is the readers or yours? I would repeat the question. As you write stories as a writer, most of the time you have to keep the readers in mind. So when they read the story, they read it in their perception. Now, what is the final outcome? Is it your story or the reader's story?
What is the first question?
The question is, how much the readers influence your story?
Okay, I got it. Readers do influence you. Because what happens, you can't, even if you are a fantastic dancer, you can't dance properly in an empty place. You need audience. Likewise, you begin with no reader. What it happens at the beginning, you begin with no reader. But once you are inside the readers, definitely they influence you. But there is also another side to it. They influence you, you also want to influence them. Because the tendency is, if you don't have certain anything new, the readers will not accept you. So you have to speak something which they did not know. If they know that, your offering will not be that fantastic. So therefore, they influence you, but at the same time, a good writer has always the tendency to influence the readers in his own way. Second is, yes, most of the writings are autobiographical. We usually, you see, when I speak in the first person, you would be interested to know that why I became Das Benhur. That must have interested you because that is in the first person. So it happens, the writers give their own stories, their experiences, their feelings, their, say, imagination to the readers. But at the same time, we also collect facts, plots. Say, for example, I came across a kind of news report about a child who died inside the school because nobody knew that he was inside the bathroom and he remained there and the school was closed for the vacation. It is a very gruesome incident, but I wanted to take it to the story fold. So it happens. Usually, a good writer gives his own story to the readers, and at the same time, he also picks up readers' stories in his plots. Did I satisfy you?
Yes, sir. I think so. It is both the stories. Like in the beginning, you said about what is an author. Suddenly, I was reminded of Michael Foucault's "What is an Author?"
Yeah.
So you can say that reader as well as the writer, both are important to interpret a story.
Definitely, because yes, there are very few, I say, there are very few authors. We are mostly writers. Because if you look at the artists, most of them are memory artists. Very few are their original artists.
Yes, sir. Thank you. Just one question, that is, as you are talking about that, most of the learning happens through orally, by listening to the stories. Do you think that storytelling, orally, does not pass on the information to the next generation of the readers as the writing does? Information is distorted when we pass on to the readers.
Okay. Now the oral tradition has got a new technology. Even if my grandmother is telling something to me, my mother goes on recording it. So this digital change and digital recording is not leaving anything. So there was a time when oral things were being lost. But now the time has come, nothing oral will be lost because you can record the voice. So therefore, this change is to be welcome. I have seen many people in the rural and remote areas, and their oral tradition is maintained through these digital things. So three cheers for science. It is carrying our oral tradition to another medium, not to the written medium. Because all these books, I tell you, it is only 550 years old. Because printing press came to us, the span is only 500 years. Before that, the palm leaves, before that, but we carry the tradition of literature, even Vedas. When this Ramayana was written, there was no written form. It was not written, it was being remembered. So therefore, this oral tradition is now having a new lease of life, new lease through this digital tradition. So I think good things will not be lost as we were losing in the past.
So that means in writing, the way it is, information is passed, so orally also it is possible.
It will be there.
Thank you so much, sir. Thank you so much.
But madam, you, what's your name?
Yes, sir.
What's your name?
Sir, my name is Varsha Panigrahi. I'm a TZ English.
Varsha Panigrahi.
Yes, sir.
Fantastic.
Thank you.
Good afternoon, sir. Sir, I'm Shavni Das. I wanted to ask, sir, that as a writer who has written more than 100 books, what drives you? Like, how do you keep on writing? Why do you not get demotivated by the negative influence and reviews you get from your readers?
Varsha madam has already told that. If you get the feedback from the readers, an article is published, you get a sweet voice, sir, it was really nice, fantastic, you get inspired.
No, sir, but what about the negative influence? Like you said that writing should be a continuous process. So why, what keeps you writing your process continuous?
I tell you, if you want to lead a good life, always avoid the negative things. You always try to get the positive things. Do you know, I tell you, this Ratnakara, even if it is a story, he was a violent person, a bad person. How he became good, do you know this? Vishwamitra told him to always utter Rama, Rama. That means, Rama means good, Shubha. If you always look at positive things, think positively, your own standard will grow. It is like manure to your mind. Could you get the point? So I know there are many people, critics are there, they will say negative things. When, say, this Kohli, he is now listening to, he is now getting negative reports. But if he looks at it, he will not grow. So a good writer will never care for these negative remarks. Even in your own life, don't care for the negative remarks. So long as you know that my direction is positive. Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you. Thank you so much, children. Thank you, ma'am, for all your queries. And thank you so much, sir, for taking all those questions with due patience. Now, it's a good news for all of us that Professor Das has gifted us some books and by his own. May I request our librarian, sir, to kindly accept all those books for our school library.
Book is not yet released. I am fortunate. It is now released by Dr. K.C. Satpathy. It runs into 700 pages.
Thank you so much, sir. It will definitely add a treasure to our treasure trove. Well, now it's time to express our gratitude to this eminent author. May I request our revered principal, sir, to kindly felicitate this dynamic author that we do have with an Uttariya and a plant and a school magazine. May we request Professor Das to accept our token of gratitude. And at the same time, may I request all our young friends to have a huge round of applause for such a lovely afternoon. You all, please take your seats. Thank you so much, sir. It was absolutely a delight to listen to you all. And it's time to propose the vote of thanks. May I invite on stage Dr. Devendra Kumar Pathy to please propose vote of thanks. So please.
Pranam, sir. Pranam, amara baranya. सर्वपूज्य अध्यक्ष महोदय सम्मानास्पदा संयोजिका महोदया अति अंतरंग मुख्य ग्रंथागारिक उपस्थित सम्माननीय तत्वावधारक मंडली सहकर्मी वृंद एवं प्राणप्रिय छात्र छात्रीगण जहाँ प्रथम आमर सम्मानास्पद अध्यक्ष महोदय कही वास्तविक आज गोटे अत्यंत महत्वपूर्ण एवं स्मरणीय दिवस। प्रथम कृतज्ञता मोर अर्पण जे देशर आसंता कालीर मंगुआल हेबे भाग्य विधाता हेबे मोर विदग्ध छात्र समाज को सुदीर्घ 21 वर्ष रही शिक्षकता भितर एभली एक मनमय मंत्रमुग्ध समावेश खूब कम मु प्रत्यक्ष करी तेणु प्रथम धन्यवाद मोर विदग्ध छात्र समाज को एते सुच्चभद्र निरवता और अंतरंगता एते ग्रहणशीलता खूब कम मु देखी तेणु मोर अति आदर छात्र छात्री माने विशेष धन्यवाद पात्र और पात्री। आज जी बरण्य अतिथि अच्छा आम समस्त सर्वपूज्य गुरुजी गुरुणांग गुरु तांकु कृतज्ञता जनेबार परिभाषा मो पाखरे नाही। आज दिन पूर्व मु दुई थर तांकु आम विद्यालय को अतिथि रूपे पाइबा पई प्रगाढ़ प्रयत्न करी विफल होती अन्याडे कार्यक्रम थिला सारंग सहित पाखापाखि अर्ध शताधिक कार्यक्रम में सामिल थी सारंग वक्तव्य शुणी प्रति थर सारंग वक्तव्य नूतनता और नवीनता मु उल्लेख करी जोटी सारे जमी भाव भाषण दिंतु से किसी नूतनत्व निश्चित थाए सारे तो मतलब पचारे तुम स्कूल पिला मानक मु कौ भाषा कह इंग्राजी कह ओडियार कह मैं सारे निष्पत्ति आपणकर आम पिला सर सब बुझे ओडिया बुझीपरि इंग्रेजी भल बुझीपरि आपड़ जो थे सुविधा हे स्वच्छंद दिखते या पूर्व आम जो मीट दि अथर प्रोग्राम करूँ विजय नायक सर आसते दिवंगत देवाशीष पाणिग्राही महोदय आसी डॉक्टर गौररी दास आसी सदानंद त्रिपाठी महोदय आसते राज्यवर्धन धल महापात्र आसते से मैंने इंग्रेजी ओडिया दीटा को मिसई कौते आम पिलांकर श्रोतांकर ग्रहणशीलतार केबे अभाव नथला किंतु तथापि का भा मु शुणी जे ओडिया टिके बुझी हलाने तो आज आउ से अवकाश नथिबो केही कोउठी सामान्यतम भ्रुकुंचन करिबोनी जे वक्तव्यर काणीचा अंश कियदंश मु बुझी पारली ना एते प्रांजल भाव रे सरल समस्त को स्पर्श कला भली इंग्रजी भाषा रे सार कहिसंती जेहेतु आमर एक इंग्रजी माध्यम विद्यालय तेणु ग्रहणशीलता शत प्रतिशत निश्चित से सारंकु सर्वप्रथम कृतज्ञता सारंकु मोर कृतज्ञता षडमुखी बरण्य सारंकु मोर कृतज्ञता षडमुखी छह प्रकार कृतज्ञता मुझे चाहूँगी से पाखुड़ार कृतज्ञता फुलर मोर छटी पाखुड़ा प्रथम पाखुड़ा है तांकर भाषा चयन से समस्त को स्पर्श कर आंतरिक प्रयास करेणु से इंग्रजी भाषा को पसंद कर प्रथम आम निमंत्रण को आमंत्रण को सादरे ग्रहण करमर जो दीर्घ दिन अभीपसा था ताको साकार रूप दे सारानिध्य आम पाइचु केत समय चलीगला ये ग्रहणशीलता और ये निरवता ता प्रमाण करदे व्यक्तित्व विशालता और महानता वक्तव्य जी अत्यंत उच्चकोटीर प्रभावशील कहवा निसंदेह से कौन सन्देह ना तृतीय कथा है से आमको समस्त को एपरिक छात्र को जहाँ जरिया से आज तर अप्रकाशित पुस्तक उन्मोचन करदे के महानता देखु जिते प्लाटो तर एकाडेमी करते लेखा को संशोधन कले छात्र गर्वर से फुली उठी छात्र मैंने सब बड़े गुरु परंपरा को आगक नहीं जी एम महानता तामर विशेषत्व सारंक जरिया सम्माननीय अध्यक्ष महोदय हाथ से अप्रकाशित पुस्तक उन्मोचन करदे आम समस्त को बंधु बोली से संबोधन कर बंधु तार संज्ञा बहु व्यापक बहु पास उत्सव व्यसने चैब दुर्भिक्ष राष्ट्र विप्लवे राजद्वारे श्मशान जतिष्ठति सबान्धव चाणक्य महान बाणी आप सर खाली बंधु बोली संबोधन करना चिरकाल आम सुख दुखर साथी आपम सहित आम आप सहित रही आम वचनबद्ध आमर समृद्ध पाठागार को सारंकर बहु कीर्तिमान पुस्तक से उपहार देचंती से परवर्ती पीढ़ी पर निश्चित अमूल्य उपहार हबो व्यक्ति आसीबो चली जिवो किंतु पाठागार सबुबेले रहितिबो चिरकाल जाजुल्यमान कीर्ति जो कथा माकले कहते भारत बर्षर गोटे पाठागार समग्र यूरोपर ज्ञान गंताघर सहित समान तो से आंतरिक कृतज्ञता आम समस्त को बयस निर्विशेष आपण प्रज्वलित करीपित करदीपित करम भितर स्वप्न तितीक्षा जिज्ञासा सबू जाग्रत करदे मनमय करदे से आंतरिक भाव आपण को कृतज्ञता एमती एकाधिक कारण ये कृतज्ञतार हृदय स्तवक आम समस्त तरफ आपण आम भेटी दौचु बरण्य अध्यक्ष महोदय को कृतज्ञता जनवर परिभाषा ना कारण ये समग्र कार्यक्रम पटपुरोधा होती सी ये कार्यक्रम प्रथम उपोद्घाता होती सी थे से जाते जन वक्ता चमत्कार भाषण शुणी आसला कहले पाने एत जिनस पढ़ुंट आम कौन एम कार्यक्रम विद्यालय आयोजन करें नेशनल बुक वीक भितर से कार्यक्रम टी संयोजन है स्वप्न को साकार रूप देवार प्रयास करते आम ग्रंथागारिक प्रदीप पंडा महोदय आय मान समस्त अकुंठ एवं सदिच्छा एवं सहयोग आ समस्त कार्यक्रम सूत्र जे कि सुंदर भाव में माला भाव में सजे दिखती आमर सम्माननीय संयोजिका महोदय सबू कार्यक्रम को सुंदर भाव में सुचारू रूप से संपादन करवा उपस्थापन करद्वितिया तेणुता विशेष कृतज्ञता जिते सहकर्मी अच्छा ये कार्यक्रम टी समस्त निश्चित भाव में निरा कार्यक्रम एनसी व्यस्तता ना धाँ दौड़ ना कि ना केवल उन्मुक्तपण से ग्रहण करनेबार जो आकुलता जो उदग्रता जो उन्मुखता से समस्त को ये कार्यक्रम सहित परोक्ष प्रत्यक्ष भाव में संपुक्त थिबा तत्वावधारक मंडली सहकर्मी बृंद शिक्षक शिक्षयित्री अणशिक्षक कर्मचारी भाई भौणी माने समस्त को आंतरिक कृतज्ञता जनावु आपण मान समस्त सदिच्छा सहयोग आग को आम को आहरी कर्म तत्मर हबार को प्रेरणा जगेब एवं आहरी आम को यही प्रज्ञानशील हबार बार्ता आम को दब सभी बनी जातु कवि डीएवी चंद्रशेखरपुर बनी जाऊ साहित्य और कवितार विपुल पृथ्वी जय जगन्नाथ वंदे उत्कल जननी।
With this, we have come to an end of this enlightening session. May I request all of you for Bande Utkal Janani.
Bande Utkal Janani, Bande Utkal Janani, Bande Utkal Janani.
Dear students, kindly remain on your position. You will move according to the instructions. Please wave your hands to our guest of the day.